Okay, thank you everyone for joining us today for our Geo4Dev workshop on open data and tools for nighttime lights. We really appreciate you joining. I think this is gonna be a great opportunity and a great follow-up to our symposium yesterday to really learn how to use the data sets and the tools that were discussed by our speakers at the symposium. We really appreciate everyone who was able to join yesterday, and we hope that you'll enjoy this workshop. I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Dana Kruhl, who'll be running the workshop today, and we'll give a short introduction to what we'll be going through. Dana, over to you.
Great. Thanks, Sam. Can you hear me all okay?
Yep, we can hear you.
Hey, well, welcome everyone. Dana Kruhl, I'm a data scientist with New Light Technologies, and I'm joined by my colleagues from SIGA and my colleagues from NLT, Ron and Gabe, who you heard from yesterday. And I'm also very thrilled to mention we have a special guest, Dr. Kimberly Baugh, who's coming to us from the Earth Observation Group at CU Boulder. And many of you probably know Dr. Baugh, but she's going to be talking to us about the data in a little more detail here in a moment. So I'm very excited about that. But just to talk a little bit about today, well, first of all, I'm gonna be spending a few hours with you. So just so you know who I am. Data scientist who specializes in satellite data and doing that with NLT. And I've done that with other organizations previously, including the World Bank. My research interests are really on the applications of data science and machine learning to make data like this more accessible and scalable for analysis for folks ranging from economists to city planners and everything in between. And I'm just personally inspired by the natural sciences. So for me, it's kind of a perfect match to be a data scientist working with remote sensing and thinking about how data we observe and instruments that we build to collect data can help us understand the world. And I'm particularly interested in cities. And I live in one, New York City. So that's where I'm coming to you from. I won't go to NLT a little bit, but just as a background, obviously we do a lot of work with remote sensing and cloud computing, and we have a pretty broad depth of, a broad base of expertise and a depth of that as well. So I'd love to just follow up with anything if you guys have questions about the kind of work we do, but we have, I think, a lot of touch points in terms of the work with remote sensing and work with geospatial analytics, and that's, of course, what I focus on. Okay, so what are we going to do today? Well, we're going to have a few blocks of activity here. Trying to keep it manageable, but we'll have about 4 hours worth of content, and we're going to have these blocks of about an hour each, and we're going to save a few minutes for breaks, bio breaks and what have you. We're not going to take a long break for lunch or anything like that. So if you're coming to us from the West Coast, we'll get through this and you can get lunch afterwards. If you're on the East Coast like me, hopefully you got some nibbles and you're ready for the afternoon. So very first thing we're gonna do, and I'm gonna introduce her in a second here, we're gonna hear more about remote sensing. We've heard a lot of great stuff yesterday. We heard a lot of really incredible stuff about the background and the use of data, this data for analysis, but we're really gonna get into the details of how this data are produced, how we, what we need to know about them in terms of the data structure and using the data. So thankful again for Kim's joining us. And then we'll take a brief break and for a few minutes and then dig right into the workshop, and I'll introduce some of the open data and the tools we're using. And we'll get into doing some work with basic visualizations and doing some analysis with remote sensing and nighttime lights data, and even some statistical analysis in the segments to follow. And so I'll walk through in more detail when we get to those sections. But just to kind of think of some goals for today, because I think it kind of helps us orient things. If you take away anything, you're not going to take away expertise in any of these if you didn't have it already. That's not the real aim here. What we really want to do is help you get a better understanding of the data and appreciation for how it can be applied. All right, that's sort of goal number one. And hopefully you have that already, and this just sort of strengthens it. Secondly, think about data critically. I know that may seem obvious, but what you're going to hear from Kim and what I'm going to reiterate is that your choices in working with this data matter, and that starts with understanding the data, how it's produced, what are some of the qualities and attributes of the data in terms of the file structure and the science and the mechanism behind it. So 2 and 3, I think, are really kind of where I put my data science cap on, but I think all of us, if you're here, you're looking at this data, you're interested in it, you're potentially making decisions you're potentially passing on recommendations to other decision makers. The power is in your hands and the responsibility to do that. So hopefully today you can kind of understand that better in relation to the nighttime lights domain. And then of course, we're gonna learn by doing. Learn how to access the data. We're gonna learn how to visualize it, do some simple tasks. We're gonna look at some basic tools. I've done a number of these technical workshops, and usually I like to focus fairly narrowly on something because when you get technical, it's good to get in the weeds. It's good to kind of keep the scope narrow, but go deep. Because we're doing this virtually and because we have such a large group of attendees, which is wonderful, I don't think that's the right approach because I think it'll be hard to hit the right target where we're all finding something that we're interested in. So what I'm going to do instead is cover a fairly broad scope of tasks and things related to the data that you can work with. The trade-off then, of course, is that we're going to move at a brisk pace and we're going to cover some ground. If you get stuck on something or you want to spend some time on something, that's okay. We are providing the link to the tutorial and this content so that you can work through this stuff on your own. We're also going to make this recording available. So we want to make sure that you get the most out of today, but we are going to move through some work. And if you don't fully grasp a concept, believe me, that is quite okay. It might take some time to kind of work through something, but I hope you at least walk away with a sense of how you can use these tools to explore the data and learn further. That's really the goal. And so I just kind of mentioned this, but so our guidelines in terms of practical matters, if you were all here yesterday, you know that we have this QA tool. Again, because we have a large group virtually, I and the moderators will try to do our best to answer the questions that come up. It's gonna be hard to sort of interact. Some of you may have some issues with something we're doing, something's not working, you get an error. That will happen. People get stuck on things. Try to work through it. If you have a question, pose it in the Q&A tool. And if you can answer the question, if you're also someone who's obviously an expert or a specialist, or even just someone who's got the answer, please feel free to chime in and answer the questions. We're all an open community here. We're all here to help each other. And again, I can't stress this enough. If you get stuck on something, flag it to look at it later and move along with us, but don't feel bad, please. It's okay. If we spent some time really doing one or two tasks, then we'd want to try to see if you can master them. But right now, we just want to get you exposed to a number of things. And again, we're going to provide the resources. So speaking of which, this is a link we shared last night. Here it is again. Sam or someone, if you guys haven't already shared this in the chat or the Q&A, this is going to take you to the main content that we're going to be working through today. All you need to access this is a browser and internet, which you probably already have if you're on this call. So through this, we're developing a tutorial, and this is in partnership with the World Bank, University of Michigan, NOAA, and certainly Kim's been a key partner in this, and New Light Technologies. It's in development, so you are all actually, I would think, literally the first folks publicly to see this tutorial outside the core team. So congratulations, but it is a work in progress, so bear with us. Hopefully you'll get a lot out of this content, but it is sort of growing as we work. I mentioned in the prep email that to get the most out of this, it would be useful for you to have a Google account and access to Earth Engine. I'm hoping most of you do. That will allow you to actually work through the code that we're doing. If you don't, that's okay. We're going to work through the content. You can access this website. You can access the tutorial. You can work through this content without it. But if you do have an account, then you can actually work through this code. And I think that will be hopefully interesting for you. I'm going to get into more details later. Just want to make sure you guys have access to that. So without further ado, then I want to introduce Dr. Kimberly Baugh. And again, very, very pleased that she's joining us today. She's a research scientist at the Cooperative Institute for Research and Environmental Sciences at CU Boulder. She's been working for 25 years within the Earth Observation Group at NOAA National Centers for Environmental Information as a lead developer for nighttime lights product generation. Her work has utilized nighttime data from the VIRS instrument and the DMSP satellites, developing algorithms to produce three global product lines: nighttime lights, nighttime boat detections, and fires at night. I think products most of us, if not all, are very familiar with. And I can attest to this personally. She continues to work with NOAA to make these satellite data more accessible to the research community as she's helping us with our own group and effort here. So Gabe, I'll kick over to you to cue up Kim's video and take it from here, and I will stop sharing my screen.
Good morning. My name is Kim Baugh, and I am going to deliver the tutorial module one content for you today. It is on introduction to remote sensing and introduction to nighttime lights. So let me share my screen and we'll get started. Okay. So get the cat out of here. Again, my name is Kim Baugh. I work for the Cooperative Institute for Research and Environmental Sciences at the University of Colorado Boulder. And I work within the NOAA National Centers for Environmental Information. I have been working with the, I've worked for CERES within NOAA NCEI for 26 years. I've worked with the DMSP archive since 1994. And with the VIRS since 2012. And I am really excited today to bring what I have done into this training and present to you. So let's get started. So again, this is tutorial module one, intro to remote sensing. It's going to be a very high overview, just a few minutes about what remote sensing is, what different resolutions mean, and some applications to socioeconomic research. And then we'll go more into kind of my wheelhouse, the nighttime lights, and talk about remote sensing of nighttime lights. And then specifically dive into DMSP OLS and VIRS day and night band data sets and a little history there. Everything that I am saying to you today can be, I know you got this link before, but all the content is here in this World Bank GitHub repository, Open Night Lights. And so you can refer back to it, and there will be more content added. It's a dynamic process. I'm working on a 1.3 for this module one as well. So you can check back there and get updates. So what is remote sensing? So just at the definition level, it's the science of identifying, observing, collecting, and measuring objects without coming into direct contact with them. We are going to be talking about satellite remote sensing, and specifically two polar orbiting satellites that would be up in this, get this laser pointer up, would be sitting about here at about 800 kilometers above the Earth. But these are other examples of things that can do remote sensing. Remote sensors can be split into two groups, passive and active. Passive sensors, as the name suggests, just records passively. It records energy that is naturally reflected from or emitted from the Earth's surface. It could be sunlight, moonlight, city lights, and the sensor is just recording. Active sensors will provide their own energy source and emit it, and then will collect what comes back. Radar and LIDAR are two common examples. Passive remote sensing deals with recording reflection or emission in this electromagnetic spectrum. The visible light is here, this small range in here is what we can see, visible light. And the sensors that we'll be talking most about today are the visible out into the near infrared. So here to about there, we'll be working with. Again, with passive remote sensing, it's important to remember there's a lot of things going on. You have a source, electromagnetic radiation source, transmits through the atmosphere onto whatever you might be interested in imaging, and then that light scatters, and then it will go back to your sensor. If you've got like a long wave thermal band, then it will absorb from the sun and re-emit, and it's that re-emission that that you're sensing. But we are going to be again concerned with today with the visible near infrared, and so that would be scattering if you're looking at moonlight, or just emitting if you're looking at like city lights and things. So in remote sensing analysis, we aim to learn about objects on Earth through studying the radiation reflected and or emitted by them. And so then now let's talk about different resolutions. So when we talk about resolution, there's three different kinds that we're going to talk about today. Spatial resolution signifies the ground surface area that forms one pixel in the image. But you can resolve subpixel objects. So sometimes you have something within a pixel that is either different enough from its surroundings or bright enough in the case of nighttime lights that you can actually see things that are subpixel. It doesn't have to fill the whole pixel for you to be able to resolve it. And so here in the top, we've got Landsat 7, 30 meters, Sentinel 2 at 10 meters, and WorldView, WorldView 2 probably at 50 centimeters. And you can see that as you go down in resolution, down in pixel size, you see a lot more detail. And then another kind of resolution, spectral resolution, signifies the number and width of spectral bands of the sensor. So the higher your spectral resolution is, the narrower the wavelength range. And so here's two examples, multispectral imagery, where you have kind of wider bands across wavelength ranges, and then a hyperspectral, where you've got a lot of narrow bands. We are actually going to be looking at the DMSP and VIRS day-night band that just have one panchromatic band that cover a really broad, they cover like from here in the green out to the near IR. So really broad, one broad band. So the other resolution is temporal resolution, which refers to the repeat cycle or frequency with which a sensor revisits the same part of the Earth's surface. So if you hear a revisit time of 3 hours, that would be the time in which you would see that same part again. In this course, we're going to be using the day-night band and OLS data, and both of these sensors image the same Earth location once during the day and once during the night. And since we're just interested in the nighttime pass, our data can be considered to have a daily temporal resolution. And sometimes we will temporally aggregate these data to kind of reduce the noise and account for obstructions such as cloud cover. So we'll also be looking at working with composite data. This figure in the middle here, there's trade-offs in everything in life. It's true in remote sensing resolution as well, that you can have high spatial resolution, but that often means that you don't have high temporal resolution, that you wouldn't see that, that spot again and again, or like every night. And then if you have high spectral resolution, you often can't have as high a spatial resolution. So anyway, these are kind of competing factors for resources on a satellite. Applications of remotely sensed derived data in socioeconomic research. I would say we saw a lot of that yesterday, a lot more than I'm going to show you here. A lot of you are socioeconomic researchers, and I learned a lot yesterday listening to your talks. But the three things that nighttime lights can do is for socioeconomic research is it can improve accessibility to information difficult to obtain by other means. And I said nighttime lights, but this is actually for any satellite sensor. You can have access to a place that might be otherwise difficult to get to. It can have higher spatial resolution than other means, like census data, you know, can't get down to your even the resolution of a nighttime lights pixel. And then it can have wide geographic coverage and a higher temporal resolution than what you can do with other means of getting socioeconomic data. Here's an example of using nighttime lights for GDP estimates. And so this is a area of light versus GDP for 200 different countries and shows a strong correlation there. Here's another example. It's more recent, and instead of just GDP, there were many socioeconomic and other factors. There were CO2 emissions. They found strong correlations between nighttime lights and electricity consumption, CO2 emissions and GDP, population, methane, and other gases. So as you all know, you're here and have probably seen a lot of these studies, but here's two examples. So in summary, remote sensing instruments collect electromagnetic energy and they map a variety of phenomena on the Earth's surface. There's typically a trade-off between the three categories, spatial, spectral, and temporal. Remotely sensed imagery can reach all parts of the world at a consistent resolution. And we do have some archives that go back decades, Landsat and even nighttime lights goes back to 1992. In this course, we're going to focus on those nighttime lights from the Veers day-night band and the older DMSP OLS. And there is a lot of research showing correlation between nighttime lights and socioeconomic variables. Okay, so introduction to nighttime lights data. So this is my wheelhouse here. So first we're gonna talk about the OLS because it's been around the longest. Low light imaging of the Earth from space has been a capability since the mid 1960s with sensors on board the DMSP, Defense Meteorological Satellite Program, satellite platforms. DMSP is a US Air Force series of polar orbiting satellites with sensors on board that were originally designed to observe weather-related indicators at day and night in the visible and infrared wavelength ranges. In 1973, Thomas Croft first reported that information collected with the DMSP OLS, visible near-infrared band, was able to capture various sources of low-light emissions from Earth. These include sources that indicate aspects of human activity like city lights, gas flares, fishing boats, agricultural fires, while also capturing other nighttime lights phenomena such as aurora. While the DMSP series to this day has satellites orbiting and collecting nighttime data, the program will end when the current satellites reach their end of life. There are no other satellites to launch. I brought these images to this presentation because it shows just how long this DMSP has been up. These are two images from 1974, and it's some of the earliest published data that I could find in the literature. So they show the same things that we're seeing like today, like last night's DMSP data would show similar things. They'd show aurora, city lights, we have gas flares, agricultural fires across the band. This is Africa, by the way, and this is the US. And this is Europe. So city lights of Europe, gas flares in Libya, Algeria. We have agricultural fires across the central part of Africa, and then these gas flares off of the coast of Nigeria. So these are single orbits of data. Okay, and then the VIRS day-night band. The follow-on sensor to the DMSP OLS was first launched in late 2011 on board the SUMI NPP, SUMI National Polar Orbiting Partnership satellite. This new low-light imaging sensor is part of the Visible Infrared Imaging Radiometer Suite, or VIRS, and is called the day-night band, or DNB. While similar to the DMSP OLS in many ways, the VIRS DNB offers a dramatic improvement to nighttime lights imaging from its predecessor. The SNPP satellite was intended as a transition satellite, combining requirements of the legacy satellites of two US agencies, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA, and the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, or NASA, into a new program called the JPSS, the Joint Polar Satellite System. The first official JPSS satellite, so we had the NPP, which was the transition satellite, and then the first official JPSS, JPSS-1, was launched in late 2017 and was renamed NOAA 20 after reaching orbit. So you'll see that written as NOAA 20 sometimes and J1 sometimes. And there are three other satellites, actually, they're down in here, that are planned to fill out the JPSS constellation. JPSS 2, 3, and 4 have launch dates scheduled currently in 2022, 26, and 31, respectively. And for us, the Nighttime Lights user community, this means access to really a continuous record of VIRS day-night band observations well into the fourth decade. NPP has been going now for, I guess we're about to hit its ninth year. So I would expect these to, perform similarly. And so we're looking at almost into 2040 to have VIRS day-night band data available. And so this timeline shows the DMSP series and the JPSS series from the start of when we had digital data. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. This is just a fun video that from JPSS program that shows the J1 and NPP satellites orbiting the Earth. And the green is kind of laying out their swaths. So like what they would, what one orbit images along the Earth. And NPP and J1 are half an orbit apart. So they actually do function just like this with the NPP coming up and then the J1 coming up. And I included this in this presentation today, just in case words like polar orbiting, sun synchronous, and just to have a visual about what that means. So these satellites on one side are imaging the day, and then as they go over the pole on the other side, they're imaging the night. And so I'll be using those words, polar orbiting, sun synchronous, and things like swath. And so these are the things that I'm talking about. Okay, so more about the DMSP satellites. The first low light imagery from DMSP dates back to the mid 60s. But even though we had data back that far, it wasn't until 1992 that a digital data archive was established at NOAA and CEI. And it used to be called the National Geophysical Data Center. So you'll see both of those. We got renamed about 4 years ago when we merged with the two other NOAA data centers. So into National Centers for Environmental Information. So prior to 1992 and the establishment of the digital archive at NOAA and CEI, only a limited set of DMSP OLS data were ever preserved and written to a large format film. And then some of the DMSP OLS analog films have been digitally scanned for preservation and reside at the NOAA NCI archive. But it's a very small handful of limited set. And then while all DMSP satellites are sun synchronous polar orbiting platforms, their overpass times vary. And depending on the overpass time, the DMSP satellites can be categorized as either day-night or dawn-dusk. The day-night satellites have one side of their orbits imaging the daytime side and the other side imaging the nighttime side. So similar to that video I just showed. And then the dawn-dusk satellites image an early morning Earth on one side and an early evening on the other. And so it's important to note that all the DMSP satellites have an OLS, and all the DMSP OLS data contains some amount of nighttime data, but the satellites that are in a day-night orbit have the highest quality nighttime data and are usually favored for nighttime lights use. And so this is an example, or this is a graph of all of the satellites in the DMSP series that have been launched. And I've colored in yellow the ones that have quality nighttime data. So here, like F11, F13, F17, F19, if you have worked with like the stable light series before, maybe you wondered why there's no F11 stable lights image. And it's because it's in a dawn dusk orbit and wouldn't be able to make a global nighttime lights product. There's just not enough nighttime data in the swath. So anyway, that's why. Another thing I wanted to draw your attention to here is that unlike most modern satellites, the DMSP satellites have no ability to keep their orbit timing constant, and therefore the overpass times do drift gradually, and day-night satellites can become dawn-dusk and vice versa. And for these reasons, the set of DMSP OLS with high-quality nighttime data is a subset of the entire archive. And also, satellites that start, like F-15, started day-night and then became dawn-dusk and then became day-night again. So there are, and F-16 did the same. So, and I think F-18 is projected to become day-night again sometime next year. So anyway, know that that happens as well. Okay, and so a little bit about the DMSP OLS. It is an oscillating scan radiometer. It has two spectral bands. We often just talk about the VIS, but there is a companion band, long-wave thermal infrared, that we actually use for that cloud detection algorithm so we can get cloud-free composites. It has 14 orbits a day, and each day-night OLS is capable of generating global daytime and nighttime coverage of the Earth every 24 hours. So that's that temporal resolution piece. From the orbits, you can make composites. And instead of working with the OLS nightly orbits directly, many researchers choose to use the global annual nighttime lights products for their work. But know that learning how to access and interpret data from individual orbits will be part of a later training module, not today, but it will be added to that series of modules. And that will be the data that's hosted on the Amazon Web Services, AWS. These global products were created first using a series of filters on each OLS orbit to include only the data recorded under the sensor's maximum gain setting, and then discard data identified as cloud, lightning, stray light, or aurora. The OLS data that passed through these filters were then orthorectified into 30 arc second grids, composited into an annual product, and then post-processed to remove ephemeral lights, like from fires, fishing boats, and some gas flares. The remaining data were then averaged and passed through a final algorithm to set background or non-light values to zero. So that's how, you know, very brief, how these composites are made. So the set of annual global nighttime lights products were created at NGDC, which is now NCEI in the Earth Observation Group. And just a little history story about them is that they are actually never intended to be a standalone product. In 1994, Dr. Elvidge joined NGDC to lead a project using the DMS-POLS data to monitor global fire activity. As fires and lights are indistinguishable in a single overpass of the OLS visible band, part of the project was to understand where lights were stable or consistently present, as would be the case in cities, industrial sites, gas flares, volcanoes, et cetera. And then we could take an individual orbit and map it against that set of stable lights to produce a set of ephemeral lights, and most of those would be fires. And then early on in this project, Dr. Elvidge found that the OLS stable lights data sets were more requested by the scientific community than the fire product. So that intermediate product of stable lights became a standard product in their own right. And the DMSP Global Annual Stable Lights products were made consistently by the EOG group at NGDC using data from 1992 to 2013. And these are the products by satellite years. And in 2014, a production of these products was discontinued. At that time, the satellite F-18's orbit had degraded from day-night into a dawn-dusk and was just not collecting enough nighttime data to make a global annual product. We really did try to make 2014, and it just didn't work. There was just not enough data. So at that point, though, the day-night band was up and going for a few years, so the EOG group switched to working solely with the follow-on sensor, the day-night band. So in 2019, in June, Dr. Elvidge retired from NOAA and began doing research in the academic sector at Colorado School of Mines, the Payne Institute for Public Policy. He founded a new group. He named it the same Earth Observation Group, so it gets a little confusing sometimes. People get confused about where that Earth Observation Group is. It's now at the School of Mines. It was at NOAA. And he continues there to do research and product generation. And we got to hear him speak yesterday about some of the new research and where timelines are for some new products. The DMSP archive, however, for individual orbits remains at NOAA NCEI. And something of interest that, again, Dr. Elvidge alluded to yesterday was that two of the older satellites, F-15 and F-16, started their life as day-night satellites. They slowly became dawn-dusk, but they have remained operational long enough to go full cycle and become day-night satellites again. And EOG under the Payne Institute has plans to generate stable lights products using these data. And we got a timeline for that yesterday as well, that it will be mid-2021 is what he said, that those will be available. And it's pretty exciting for people wanting to do cross comparisons and cross calibrations to have that longer set of time so that we can kind of extend the record from 1992 out into you know, really 2040 or whenever we have VIRS day-night band to get consistency across that time period. And here's where you can get these data: nightly orbits at NCEI and at Amazon Web Services, which is coming soon. And this is due to a partnership with NOAA, World Bank, University of Michigan, New Light Technologies, and AWS, all work together to make that possible. That will also be part of additional tutorials as well on how to work with that data. So look for that, and I'm very excited for that as well. And then the Stable Light series are at NCEI. School of Mines is also hosting those. And then Google Earth Engine has a copy that we will actually use later today in tutorials. Okay, and so the DMSP OLS has been a real workhorse. So we've done a lot of great things with it, and it was really advanced for its time, but now it's old technology and it has been essentially unchanged since 1976 with the start of the Block 5D series of DMSP satellites. The OLS VIS, the low light imaging band, has only 6-bit quantization, so its digital values range from 0 to 63. In addition, it has no onboard calibration, so these 64 values are only relative against based on the gain in which they were recorded. And I'll tell you a little bit about how that works here. The gain of the instrument, which is you can think of as a multiplier on the signal analogous to a volume setting. It's adjusted on the fly onboard the satellite via an algorithm that takes into account the amount of expected moonlight and sunlight for the time and location. The gain is dynamic, so it's adjusting across scan. Its adjustment allows the visible band to produce meaningful imagery under a wide range of conditions, from full sunlight during the day to a dark night with the moon below the horizon. So while that's great, the drawback is those OLS gain states aren't recorded. So it's adjusting on the fly dynamically and the gain states aren't recorded. And so it makes any downstream calibration very difficult. So another limitation of the OLS is its very large spatial resolution. During the day, the OLS VIS band has a 2.7 kilometer spatial resolution, but at night it gets a little more complicated. When imaging the nighttime Earth, the OLS visible band is sensitive to a larger instantaneous field of view than during the day. The instantaneous field of view for the OLS VIS at night is about 4.9 kilometers, but then the OLS still does the same sampling scheme as during the day, producing pixels that from center to center are 2.7 kilometers apart. So during the nighttime collections, the OLS VIS only achieves a spatial resolution of about 4.9 kilometers, but has a 2.7 kilometer ground sample distance. And so you'll often see these two resolutions reported, and the spatial resolution of the daytime side is actually 2.7 kilometers, but at night, it's that 2.7 kilometers is its ground sample distance, the distance between pixel centers. And the instantaneous field of view is actually at 4.9 kilometers. So what that pixel is actually seeing or pulling radiation from is 4.9 kilometers. And then when creating the DMSP OLS stable light series, only imagery from nights with no moonlight present was included. One of the reasons for this is because under no moonlight conditions, that dynamic gain algorithm that I was talking about sets the VIS gain to its maximum value. So using only these data gives some assurance that the gain was constant. We didn't know what it was, but we could be assured that it was constant. So it was reasonable to temporarily average these VIS band values. You know, part of when we started working with the OLS is like, well, if it's constantly changing, how can we even compare these values and average these values into something meaningful? But using the very low moon, no moonlight conditions, then it was more acceptable to make these averages because the gain was maxed out. So using the highest gain settings maxed out meant that we could also image really the small lights as was possible with that OLS instrument. So dimmer lights could be detected. But the downside is always using that maximum gain setting. The visible band, remember it's just 6-bit data, saturates over urban centers. So all values have that maximum of 63. That was a lot of to take in, but it's basically these four major limitations, and it has low radiometric resolution, 6-bit, no onboard calibration, very large spatial resolution, 4.9 on the nighttime side, and it saturates in urban centers with bright lights will saturate. So those limitations of the sensor translate to limitations for the scientists trying to work with the data. So challenges for the scientists trying to use these data for their work. The OLS stable light series is challenging in urban areas. You can't really get inner urban detail because of saturation. Also, it's found that it tends to exaggerate the extent of urban areas, this blooming effect. Blooming in the literature is referring to the identification of lit areas as consistently larger than the settlements with which they are associated. And it occurs for these three primary reasons: the coarse spatial resolution of the OLS sensor, and the detection of diffuse and scattered light. So light scatters, and that's just part of that phenomenon. And so the OLS can detect light and in a pixel that doesn't actually have the light source, perhaps it's adjacent to it. And then there's a large overlap of footprints in adjacent OLS pixels. And I talked about that with that instantaneous field of view versus ground sample distance. So that's that overlap in footprints. And then the accumulation of geolocation errors in the compositing process. You know, if you're putting a year of data and you have slight geolocation errors, then they can be kind of accumulated to make a fuzzier appearance over time. This is an example of a composite. I wanted to show saturation and blooming visually rather than just to describe it. So over Chicago, I think it's F18 2013. So the last of the stable light series. This horizontal transect across Chicago is here. This is a lake. And this is that horizontal profile. So you can see across here, this stretch, that we are completely saturated in the profile. So we're at 63. And then as you go across, so anyway, you can't resolve any inner urban detail here. It's just 63 or greater, that's all you know. And then as you go out onto the lake, you can really see this blooming effect that this is just light that's scattered and then imaged because of the big pixel footprint as well. And then these all these little small towns have these huge rings around them that are likely not a real light source. They're just blooming effect. Here on the right shows the red is the saturated pixel, so you can see that almost the entire Chicago metro area and up in Milwaukee is saturated. Okay, so the absence of onboard calibration. So that's another challenge of the OLS. The OLS annual stable light series, which is derived from multiple OLS sensors and different years, aren't comparable directly without an inner calibration. So what this means is that even though we used data for these annual stable light series that were taken at their maximum gain settings, they were still over many different satellites. So each satellite has a different sensor on it. And it's still an OLS, but it's a different sensor. And so they have different max gains and they aren't calibrated. So it's all relative. And then over time, you can have sensor degradation. So like F15 2000 compared to like what will come out of Dr. Elvidge's group next year, F15 2016. So it had 16 years to degrade. And So even at its maximum gain setting, it might not produce similar DNs. So it was really apparent early on that an inner calibration was necessary to be able to utilize this really long time series. And one of the modules, I'll just go quickly here, but one of the modules in this course will walk through this procedure that was proposed by Elvidge et al. I forget the year. So it relies on three things. You pick a pseudo-invariant feature, which is a place where you say, over the time period I'm interested in, I think these lights haven't changed very much or at all. Then a reference satellite year, a year that you want everything else to be adjusted to, and a quadratic regression model. And then the model will adjust the DN values from each satellite year to your reference year. So I'll leave it at that because we will get to do it for ourselves later today. Here's an example of this was some research doing estimates of gas flare emissions from gas flares in Algeria. And at the time, this was just the time series that was available. I think it was a 2009 a paper. So looks like it goes through 2007. And so before it inner calibration, this top chart, you see that there's this huge gap between F12 and F14, what they think the estimated gas flares in billion gas flaring within a billion cubic meters is. And so this isn't very meaningful and very helpful to the research community. And after the inner calibration using the method that we will explore later today, you can see like F12 and F14 are now lying pretty well on top of each other. And the difference, the delta between F15 and F16 is smaller as well. And you can see there's a decreasing trend that was not apparent before inner calibration. So this just really shows the need that for inner calibrating the OLS before drawing conclusions. Okay, so now let's dive into the day-night band. So the day-night band, it was made to be a follow-on sensor for the DMSP OLS. So it does have a lot of the same, it was designed with the same capabilities in mind, but, decades later. So it's a much improved sensor, but many aspects are the same. They are both scanning radiometers that are capable of low light imaging. They are both on sun synchronous polar orbiting platforms. They both collect 14 orbits a day. They have very similar swath widths. But the sensor itself is so much improved over the OLS. And in fact, all four limitations that I just went through for the OLS are eliminated or reduced in this day-night band. Here's a table comparing the two, and we'll just walk through these four things here with this table, the four limitations of the OLS. So the first one was that the saturation piece, and that was because of the 6-bit quantization compared to 14-bit for the day-night band. And in addition to the 14-bit for the day-night band, there's also the day-night band is capable of collecting multiple gains settings simultaneously. So where the OLS was dynamically changing the gain and recording that, the day-night band can image multiple gains at once. So, and then it's each of those gains is 14-bit. So there's really no saturation at night in the day-night band. It's just not possible. So anyway, there's no saturation. So we've fixed that with that limitation with the day-night band. The second one is the calibration. So there is onboard calibration with the day-night band. It uses a solar diffuser to calibrate the daytime side, and then that calibration is extended into the nighttime data. And as we said, there was just no calibration for the OLS. So that allows us, like, there's two satellites up right now that you can compare those just with their radiance. You don't have to do an intercalibration between NOAA 20 and NPP day-night band. Finally, the spatial resolution is much smaller. We have a 742 by 742 for the day-night band, and here it's rounded to 5 kilometers by 5 kilometers, and you actually get 40, you can fit 44 of your day-night band pixels into one of the OLS if you do the math there. So that was the first three, and then let's talk about the blooming effect. So the blooming effect is still will still occur in the day-night band. It will just be very much reduced. It still occurs because you still do have a coarse spatial resolution compared to some lights. A 742 by 742 meter pixel can have a lot of things going on inside of it, a lot of different light sources. And so it's still a coarse spatial resolution for some light sources. And then it will detect diffuse and scattered light over areas containing no light source, just like the OLS did. It'll just be reduced. And the next slide shows, that was kind of a dry table about the difference in day-night band and OLS, but I wanted to show an example of a single night day-night band next to a single night OLS. So on the left is the day-night band, and this is the Mekong Delta region of Vietnam, November 23rd, 2014. And it's really apparent the difference here when you look at this. These are fishing boats in the ocean, and you can see individual little pinpricks of light that are just kind of a one, you know, they're merged together and unresolvable in the OLS. And you can see many examples of this looks like transportation corridors in here that are just noise in here. So that's a fun set right there to explore the difference in on the swath level. And eventually we'll have some tutorials on working directly with that swath level data. But for today, we're gonna work with a lot of the composite products. So I wanted to have some time to talk about that. So the same basic procedure for generating the nighttime lights composites as for the OLS, the algorithms changed, but it was essentially the same stuff you have to do. You have to get rid of clouds. You have to look for stray light. You have to do all the same things. The work began at within the EOG group at NOAA NCEI, and then transitioned to Colorado School of Mines at the end of 2019. The main differences, besides the quality of the day-night band between the DNB and OLS, is that the DNB is orthorectified into 15 arc second grids instead of 30, and that the monthly intermediate products are available. So we had always made monthly products for the OLS, but we didn't save them. We put them into annuals, and at the time, disk space was harder to come by than it is now, and we didn't save them. So now we saved. It was decided to save those monthly intermediate products, but they are really not as analysis ready as the stable lights. And so a few things as we're working with them today to remember is that they are not filtered for ephemeral lights. They have in them fires, aurora, fishing boats, et cetera. They do not have their background values set to zero. They've not been identified and set to zero. So background is the kind of that low level noise value that it just need, you need to be aware that, that it's not zeroed. And another thing to be aware of is that the monthly compositing is not enough time for cloudy, for really cloudy regions like equatorial or Southeast Asia, for example, to accumulate cloud-free data in every month. You have to wait for a dry season to get good data coverage. So a zero isn't necessarily zero radiance. A zero can mean no data, and you have to look at the number of coverage companion band. So that's also something to be aware of in working with the monthly composites. And then a limited set of annual stable lights is available for the Vera's day-night band. We did those for 2015 and 2016 while the EOG group was still at NOAA NCEI. And we found out yesterday that that the 2012 to 2019 will become available from the Colorado School of Mines sometime next year. This is that same example over Chicago of that I showed for the OLS. I just wanted to quickly show the lack of saturation. So you can see that in this horizontal profile right here. That this almost this whole area right here was saturated. Oh, and before I go into that, these two top images are the same. Because of the high dynamic range, it's hard to get one contrast stretch to see everything. And so we often just do two, one to see urban centers on the right, so you can really see that, but then you might think that there's nothing going on in the areas here that maybe viewers didn't detect anything here. But this is just stretched to show this urban center variation. And then here, it's a really hard contrast stretch so that you can see all these little small towns pop out. Okay, so let's get back to this profile. So this is that horizontal profile through Chicago. And remember, this whole area was saturated here. And now we have a variation from, I think this is about a 23 up to 290. So kind of like a 10 factor variation where we had nothing before, just complete saturation. And then I also wanted to show the reduced blooming effect here. Maybe it's a little hard to see right here, but you can kind of see off of out into the lake there from downtown Chicago. That there's still blooming, but it's very reduced. It almost looks like this steep drop off here into the water, but there's a little bit of blooming. Okay, and then I think on the next slide, yeah, there's the old OLS 2013 composite, and you can see all that saturation and how much more lit area you have out into the water compared to the DNB. Okay, and here's where you can get these data sets. The nightly orbits are at NOAA NCEI and soon through Amazon Web Services. And again, the same partnership between NOAA, World Bank, University of Michigan, New Light Technologies, and AWS made that possible. And composite products are available School of Mines and through Google Earth Engine, and we'll access some of those later today. Limitations and challenges. So in writing this, I had to think, okay, I'm just so happy with the day-night band compared to the OLS, but really what are its limitations and challenges? I think one of the limitations is that it's still fairly new. So the algorithms haven't developed fully, and it's getting better, and we see more and more things popping out in literature, and that it is getting more traction, but it's not quite there yet in terms of maturity level. The EOG group at Colorado School of Mines does continue to produce monthly composites. And I wrote this before I heard Dr. Elva just talk yesterday. The production of annual stable lights has yet to restart. It turns out it has restarted and they will be released next year. So that's good news for the user community. And then NASA has a black marble suite of products that are based also on the day-night band, and it had its first release in August of 2020. And while there are plans to release composite products, there's still only nightly data available. And so we'll wait to see those as well. VIRS, the other one is like the OLS, it was designed to be a weather satellite. And there's only one panchromatic band that's sensitive to wavelengths far from the visible out into the near infrared, which is far away from what the human eye can see. So for things like nighttime lights, you might want multiple channels in the visible band rather than one large pan band. And then the spatial resolution of the sensor is still too large for many applications like mapping urban morphology and detecting of really tiny settlements that might get washed out in that big pixel footprint. And while it is inevitable that someday a satellite mission tailored to the imaging of nighttime lights, like the proposed NightSat mission in the mid-2000s will become a reality. But until then, there's a much improved sensor in the day-night band to explore for the coming decades. So this is a lot of background. You can always reference back to the tutorial when needed. The rest of the today, we'll be getting our hands dirty with data and more interactive tutorials. I personally am very excited to take part in them as well, and I'm excited for the day. Thank you.
Excellent. Can you all hear me okay? We're back live.
Yes, we are.
Great. So thank you again, Dr. Baugh. Really appreciate you providing such detail on the data. And believe me, everyone, if you don't already, you will appreciate understanding that. It will help you work with this data. And I can tell by the questions that many of you fully comprehend that. So we are going to get to the practical session of our day here in a few minutes. I would like to take a 5-minute break, and we do have the ability, Kim, if you're still on, not to put you on the spot, but if there are follow-up questions, and you can continue in the chat. Kim, I'll leave it to you if you're able to speak to answer anything live, but why don't we take a 5-minute break here? And if you want to stay on and ask questions, feel free to do so. If you want to go take a bio break or something, that's up to you. And we will start the next session then at 15 minutes past the hour. So 5 minutes from now, we'll be back here.